Hey everyone, it's Oscar. I'm here to talk about drawing with charcoal today, and I have a little portrait here that I wanted to show. And this was just something I grabbed off the internet and thought it would be fun to enlarge and try out using charcoal with this colored paper. There's a few things that are worth noting to begin with. Number one, it's got a grid that's 8x6. This is very easy to do on a digital thing. And I have a corresponding grid. It might be too light to see, but 6 squares across, 8 squares up. And I'm going to abandon the grid pretty quickly because it's not really my favorite way of drawing, and it's not my favorite way of doing sight size measurement. But just some other things to think about is number one, just so that I can focus on the value of this, I also have a version of this that is black and white. So this will make me it a lot easier for me to see what areas are the darkest, what areas are the lightest. And I like using these sort of color paper. This is the cheapest children's paper you can buy. And as a result, it has like this crummy texture that's actually really fun with charcoal. And additionally, it starts off with a mid-tone. So I don't have to constantly shade to get a lot of mid-tone values. It'll start off that way. And then I'll use a little bit of white chalk to go in at the last minute and render up. And then, just as a last example of this, this is one where I applied a filter that ranged the values into only a few areas. So there's white, mid-tone grays, and pure blacks. And this is going to help me from time to time see values that I might otherwise miss, or I would overanalyze and I would compare one thing to another. Before we start on that, let me show you some of my charcoal kit. You by no means need all this, but it's just some stuff to think about while you're playing with this. You end up with four real big types of charcoal. Number one is you have block charcoal like this. And I like these because since you have the flat of it, you can see all my edges are worn down. You can fill in a lot of tone really fast, and you can avoid thinking about things in a line sensibility. You also have pencils for charcoal, and I have found that I really prefer this kind where it has a little string, and you just tear a little bit of this string down, and then, based on that piece of paper that you tore, really gotta be careful not to overdo it. Then you can sort of peel this whole thing. And I really prefer this because charcoal is so fragile that it's very easy to just break it. So a lot of times with things like charcoal pencils like that, I think I have one down here. This kind of pencil, you can see you end up using a knife to sharpen this. And you have to be so careful and meticulous, only to have it snap off anyways. So usually I don't have the patience for that. You then have blending things such as stumps, just paper towels, the almighty finger, and a chamois is sometimes useful as well. I've also got this rubber tip, and that kind of works, but it's not officially sanctioned by any academy. But there's always a joyful sense of experiment when I do art. You also have erasers. Gummy erasers are really nice. And you can form this into a very, very tiny point and use that to erase a very specific area. Also got pinkies. And then the last sort of part of your kit when you do charcoal is a bit of white medium, such as chalk. I think these are like Conti crayon or something. And I have discovered that I'm really not picky about this stuff. I've used Crayola chalk and it works fine. As long as you're thinking about hard edges versus soft edges and your values, then you're gonna be all right. Another one that I really like these, which are Creticolor. And I have a Creticolor Black also. And what I like about these is they're very, very dense and compressed. And as a result, it's a lot less likely that you'll drop it and break it, or it'll snap off. due to too vigorous a use. So that's what we're working with. Sometimes I start with a pencil to begin this, just because I know I'm going to end up having darker and darker values. Just to show you this, imagine you have a value scale here. How do you represent the blackest area, your mid-tone, and then lighter and lighter? So we can say that this is my mid-tone value. So this is darker. And then the charcoal, depending on which kind of it you're using, actually will go much, much darker. And I don't know. I might even turn this value up a little more. And then lastly, you have your white chalk. So there's sort of a value scale. And if you look at this, you can actually get like a photographer's thing and compare and contrast this. I think this one's a little too light. You can see how cross-hatching it helps out. So this is something worth knowing. And the other thing that's really useful to know about charcoal is just how versatile it is. So I can do something like this. I can blend it with my finger. I can blend it with a chamois. I can erase off of it. So let's say I have a large area. Like that. I can erase, and you can draw with your eraser. And then lastly, you can use a stump to just merge all this in. And there's sort of like little ridges on your paper. And the charcoal doesn't necessarily get into those ridges. It sort of sits on top. And when you blend, you're sort of pushing the medium into those ridges. You can also use that texture to your advantage. So yeah, I'm going to start with this. It's just the first thing I grabbed. Looks like an ebony black. And I'm going to try and just make some really basic markings for this, because I don't want to overdo this. So you can see that like, in the third square here, this is like the start of her head. Three over and two up. This is the bottom of her chin. Four over and four up. Is it four? One, two, three, four. There's sort of the side of her chin. And then her bonnet. It's kind of like there. Now this is where grids always kind of bug me, is you just spend so much time counting over and stuff that you don't actually spend any time drawing. You'll notice that I try and draw a lot with very straight lines, just because I think it makes for a more elegant piece at the end. Here. Or no, this is about 3 over. Yeah. And you can see that I'm not putting a lot of work into rendering this. I'm just trying to mark proper spots for things. And I like drawing this old lady because her face has lots and lots of interesting shape to it. And it has a lot of flavor and character, and if you only know formulas for drawing, you know, svelte anime girls, you're not going to do very well on a drawing like this. So I think it's one of those things that is enjoyable because it pushes me to try something new and test new skills. Now, at some point, I'm going to try and convert this into a sense of a time limit and see how fast I can render this. Because I am a big believer that speed is a big virtue in art. I'm saying the word big a lot today. So now that I have that in there, I'm going to try and get some of the bigger ideas of shadow going. So this is where I love block charcoal is. You can fill in a lot very, very quickly. You can also focus on hard edges. So when I'm doing this, I'm pushing the end that's on the paper harder than the end over here. And that's going to give me a hard edge on this side and a soft edge on this side. Just trying to place her ear. Now, if you squint at this, you can start seeing like a bigger value shape. It's oftentimes going to be like the entirety of the eye or the nose or what have you. And at this point, I'm already starting to abandon the grid, and instead, I'm thinking about personalized comparisons. So, for instance, I'm looking at this shadow here for the nostril, and I'm drawing a plumb bob of an XY up, and I can see in comparison how far over does this eye shadow go. The eye is a little bit further over, so I'm not looking at the grid anymore. I have enough big ideas in there that I can start playing elsewhere. I'm trying not to overthink this. I'm trying not to do too much pure detail. See, like, I'm trying to do things like cover this whole side of the cheek with shadow in one big pass. The other thing I like about these block charcoals is I can do things like a single touch of this for those eye wrinkles. That one was a little off. I try and erase very little while I do this. If you make a mistake, don't worry about it. The fun of drawing is going on to the next one. So if you make a mistake, don't erase it. Just learn something from it and go to the next problem. So you see how I'm pushing, like I just instinctually push down so that I get that hard edge versus the soft edge over here. Double checking some measurement. And this is something that I really like at this point. I can start having a blocked in background that is very, very strongly rendered as an edge. Is that background this value? No, but I really just enjoy this as a personal artistic touch because I feel like it goes very far. You want to see the areas I'm rendering. I'm trying to do this whole shadow here, and I just kind of want to make sure that edge is really strong right here for this sort of neck giblet. It's alright. This photo was taken in 1910 or something. Got it off of Wikimedia Commons. This lady's been dead so long that we can totally talk behind her back. She won't even know. So again, in detecting hard edges versus soft edges, we can look at something like this close-up detail of her shawl versus her face, and we can go for the most accurate value reading of that on like a value scale of pure black, midtones, white. But if we know that that edge is hard, I think it's more important a lot of times that I render that contrast more than I render accurate values. So that's an area where I am going to, looks like if I pull a plumb bob of the nose over, it starts a little bit above the nose, so I'll do that on mine. The other thing I like about using charcoal blocks and really focusing on the edge of it is that, you know, there's planarity of the face, so this point right here is where the side of her head starts curving backwards, and it's a slow, gradual change. But it helps my thought process that I drew this as a hard edge. The other thing to think about is that a lot of times your mental idea is that a human face is a big circle with a big line for a smile and two big circles for eyes. And those are the landmarks that you care about, so you might be able to say, oh, where is the corner of the eye? That's not necessarily how you want to think. What you should be thinking about is shadow shapes. So notice that this shadow shape for the eye It sort of comes to the middle of this square. So, and that's where it kind of starts dying off. Trying to, again, focusing on hard edges and soft edges. I'm trying to render this not in the most accurate way, but in a way that's going to make it feel interesting as a shape. I don't know how much you can see of that. Something like this side of the edge. That I don't care so much about. Yeah. If you want, now you can start blending this. And I tend to not like blending stumps. I would rather just one and done. But I think the majority of things that I've learned about art, I didn't learn because somebody told me to do it in an art video. I did it because I had this lying around and I decided, oh, I'll try it out. So have fun, experiment with it, see what you like, see what you don't. So I'm gonna go in with this Krita color, which mostly is only worth noting as it is a different hardness. And I'm gonna start drawing in some things like this. Now this is really valuable practice, but I think there's something to be said for the opposite of this, which is caricature. So I'm kind of going for accuracy in this rendering, which is an important skill to develop. But accurate drawings can also just end up kind of dull and lifeless. It is very rare that I check against the grid at this point. Instead, I'm just using the landmarks that I generated. You'll also notice that because I am drawing this from a photo, I'm using less geometry than I normally would advise. I'm not really thinking about how can I make this wrap around her. But I still am doing it occasionally, like trying to ensorcel like this cheek and have a sense of where it's going. This is where cross hatching is really nice. You can do something like draw out an edge. And cross hatch away from it. And when you blend it with something like, let's try to, you're able to get that hard edge, and the cross hatching turns into your soft edge. So this ended up soft on one side, hard on the other. So I'm doing that with like her, the cheeks, the bags under her eye. And so right here I'm doing something where I'm comparing my drawing to itself more than anything. I've drawn this up and I can see that this corner here, if you look, is about on the same x-axis as the bag under her eye. So having noticed that, I'm also gonna, just in general, do some stuff like that. That's going to help me decide where I put this and how I render it up. Now this is my usual process, which is I like rendering this as much as possible before I go in and I put in white medium. I'm also going to use this a little bit. If you think of this as the wrinkles on her forehead as sort of a continuous shape that's like, you know, from a side view, it would be like that. That means that we end up having a hard edge that starts here and gradients up, and then the lightest value is right here. And the darkest value is right here on this edge that's really hard. So I love doing that with block charcoal, because I can sort of just put this here and push it up a little. And I get that in like a very quick, elegant way. I'm actually going to go in and do this on a couple other places. You might also be noticing the strong difference in the total darkness of this versus that Creticolor worth thinking about. And I just like blocking in the background like this because it makes the figure really just pop out. Now you can really see that difference of hard edge here versus soft edge here. It's looking pretty alright. I think I'm close enough that I'm going to think about places to modify this just a little bit. I think one other thing I'm going to put in is some of these slight little shadows for like Right there. Now these shadows here, I don't know if you can see them, but right here, like on her forehead, those are a really, really strong edge where that white bonnet is sitting on top of the shadow, and then the shadow gets lighter and lighter as it goes down her head. So think about that hard edge versus soft edge as you go down. You might be noticing there's artistic principles that I care about a lot more than others, and I think it's always fun seeing what artists obsess over, because there's artists that I really enjoy who are concerned with problems that I just don't have the patience for, or they don't strike me as interesting, and there's artists who really feel like they're on the same wavelength as me, where a lot of cubism was just a constant obsession with hard edge versus soft edges. And I'm not the biggest fan of cubism, but I can totally get where their mind was when they were thinking about that. Now, what's interesting is a chamois, which is like, it's made out of sheep wool or sheepskin or something. It will take a lot more of this off than other things. Not quite as much as an eraser, but certainly more than blending it, while also blending it. Alright, let's play with white a little bit. Now, different artists use this differently, and that's okay. So, Pierre-Paul Proudhon was an Academy guy. He famously would use white medium all over. And just like, really blow through it. Other guys like Nikolai Fechin, or even Rembrandt, they'd just go boop. All done. That one dot of white on her nose. You can see it's kind of fun to just experiment maybe a little bit on her eye. On her eyelid, that is. And maybe you could call it there. Oh yeah, and then the other thing that you can do is on these larger areas. Again, I love block charcoal because you can get that. That hard edge versus soft edge, man. It's just so satisfying to me. Ugh. And like block charcoal with block chalk. You can do just a single tap. And get a lot of stuff in. Gotta get used to all these concepts. Well, practice, practice, practice. A lot of these things, I'm saying them, but they're just words. They're not going to go into your brain unless you draw. Same is true for me. I love watching other people draw. I love art tutorials. I'm always hungry for other people's knowledge. But it doesn't actually go into my bank of skills until I actually try it out. I'm doing a lot of cross-hatching now. And I'm leaving space in between these marks. I'm just assuming that your eye is going to fill it in for you. It's just so fun to me to be aggressive with this. This is a charcoal holder. At this point, I'm gonna go in and start correcting some of this. If you don't have charcoal, don't use charcoal. I mean, it's very fun in that it's so versatile and it makes a mess, but it forgives you a lot. If you want something that you can erase at a whim, this is the medium for you. But it's really no different than a ballpoint pen that you get for free at an Air Force recruiting booth. I see no difference. Just lightness and darkness. Hard edges versus soft edges. Accuracy and geometry. Mm-hmm. Something like that. The other thing that's really good about this charcoal stuff, I'm switching between a lot of things here. Paper towel is oftentimes just as good at blending as anything else. And you know, it's been a while since I've used charcoal. So one of the principal reasons I'm doing this drawing is to refresh my memory. And the way I refresh my memory is doing all these old experiments. How does chalk blend? How does charcoal blend? Do I like Criticolor? Do I like General's charcoal? And I think a lot of times people really think about art in the wrong way, just they start working on something and that's their precious baby, and so then it's so precious that they never actually work on it. And also, if it doesn't turn out right, you know, they're not going to try and make another precious baby if the first one turned out wrong. We're drawing here. It's so much healthier, in my opinion, to just see it as a journey and a process and a chance to enjoy a moment of peace. So a lot of what I'm doing now is finding areas where I cross-etched, I hatched. I don't want that to be quite so visible. This nose is now a little over dark, so I'm going to use an eraser to paint. And if you're worried about painting with an eraser, maybe start with a chamois. I'm going to just erase a little bit of this on the underside of this, not quite into the depths of the nostrils. Okay. It sort of magically becomes a reflected light. Alright, that's good enough, I think. Thanks for watching.